In the previous video, we introduced the five different security classifications and discussed held-to-maturity securities in more detail. In this video, we will be discussing available-for-sale and trading securities, as well as the associated fair value reporting procedure. When we say fair value, we essentially just mean the current market price of the security. So reporting at fair value means reporting our securities at the price that they can be sold for on the market. The fair value procedure initially records investments at cost, or the amount paid for the investment, which is later adjusted to the market value, or fair value, at the end of the period. For example, if I was to purchase an investment that required fair value reporting for $500, and the market value of the investment fell to $400, I would need to adjust my accounting records for this investment down by $100 to match the market value. We would call this a $100 fair value adjustment. I would also have to report an unrealized loss on this investment for $100. We use the term unrealized loss here to refer to the fact that the investment has not yet been sold. This procedure is applied to the entire portfolio of investments rather than individual investments. So instead of looking at the cost and the market price for each investment one at a time, we can look at the total cost and compare to the total market value of our portfolio to determine the necessary adjustment. The two security types that should be reported at fair value are called available for sale and trading securities. We will use a Venn diagram to show the similarities and differences between these two types of investments. First, let's start in the intersection of the circles, where we will list the characteristics of both available for sale and trading securities. The main similarity between the two security types, and the reason we are discussing them in the same video, is because they are both reported at fair value, which we have already discussed briefly and will elaborate on with journal entries next. Also, both investment types can be either debt or equity securities. If the security is a debt security, the company must not plan to hold it until maturity, of course, because we have a separate classification for held-to-maturity securities, which was discussed in the previous video. As for trading securities, these are securities that are actively traded for profit. Frequent purchases and sales are made on these investments in order to make short-term profit. Related to the previous point, this means that trading securities are always current assets because they are actively being traded. On the other hand, available for sale securities are not actively traded for profit, but that doesn't mean they have to be long-term assets. Available for sale securities can be either current or long-term assets. There's one more key difference between available for sale and trading securities, which is very important, and that is where the unrealized loss or gain is reported. Remember that an unrealized gain or loss means a gain or loss on an investment that has not yet been sold. For trading securities, unrealized gains and losses are reported on the income statement. The reasoning here is that because trading securities are actively being traded, even though the investment has not yet been sold, it should still be included in income. The key thing to remember is that the unrealized gain or loss account that is used with trading securities is a temporary account that gets closed out each period. Remember this as it will become important when we look at an example with journal entries. For available for sale securities, any unrealized gain or loss is reported in the equity section of the balance sheet. So the gain or loss is reported, but does not affect the company's net income. Since the unrealized gain or loss is reported on the balance sheet for available for sale securities, the account is a permanent account whose balance will carry forward every period. Now that we understand what available for sale and trading securities are, let's look at some of the related journal entries. On December 31, 2020, Perfect Day Corporation owned the securities listed below, which are listed in this table right here. These securities are being held as long-term investments. On this date, the total market value of these securities was equal to its cost. The securities are not held for influence or control over the investees. We are to prepare journal entries for the listed information, which is given here in blue. Since the problem says that these securities are long-term investments, we know they are not trading securities, as trading securities can only be current assets. Therefore, we know that we are dealing with available for sale securities. There are only small differences in the journal entries between available for sale securities and trading securities, and I will try to point them out as we go. If you want practice with a problem related to trading securities, Check out the practice problem found in the PDF associated with this video. The first journal entry on April 1st, 2021 says that we received $1.50 per share dividend on Apple Incorporated stock. If we look over here at our table, we see that we have 1,000 shares of Apple stock. So the dividend is going to be the 1,000 shares multiplied by $1.50 per share equals $1,500. So the company is going to be receiving $1,500 in cash. So we debit our cash account. And the credit we use here is dividend revenue. Next, on July 1st, 2021, we sold 500 shares of Coca-Cola Incorporated stock at $43 per share, less brokerage fees of $500. So the first step would be to calculate how much cash the company is bringing in with this transaction. So to do that, we take the 500 shares sold, multiply by $43 per share, and then subtract the brokerage fees of $500. And when we do that calculation, we see that the debit to cash is going to be for $21,000. Next, I'm going to skip a line because I don't know if I'm going to have a gain or a loss yet, and that's what's going to go in this line, so I'm going to leave that blank. And the next thing we need to do is to get the investment off of our books. So to get rid of the investment, we're going to credit it because it's an asset account, and that's going to be the long-term investment, AFS, which stands for available for sale. Now, this is where if you had trading securities, instead of AFS, you would put trading securities right here. And the way we find this number is we take the number of shares that were sold, 500, and then multiply not by the price, but the cost, the original cost that these shares were purchased at, which over here we can see is $45 for Coca-Cola. So 45 multiplied by 500 shares is equal to $22,500. Next, we have to determine whether or not we have a gain or a loss on the sale of our investments. There are a few different ways we can do that. One way is to realize that we were only receiving $21,000 for something that we originally paid $22,500 for. So we're not getting quite as much money back as we paid for. So that means we have a loss on the sale of long-term investments. And the amount of the loss is really just the difference between these two numbers, which is $1,500. Now, another way to determine whether or not we have a gain or a loss is to first figure out whether or not the difference is going to go on the debit side or the credit side to balance the journal entry. If the difference has to go on the debit side, then you know you have a loss, whereas if it has to go on the credit side, you will have a gain. Next, on the last day of the year, which is 12/31/2021, we need to make the fair value adjustment journal entry. And that's going to be based on this information over here. So we're given the three different types of stock that we own and the fair value or the market value as of this date. So the first step is to determine how many shares of each stock that we own. And if we look back at the previous chart, we see how many shares that we owned as of December 31, 2020. Now for Apple and AT&T, there were no purchases or sales of those stock. But for Coca-Cola, on 7/1/2021, there was 500 shares of Coca-Cola stock which were sold. So now we know that the new totals are 1,000 for Apple, 1,500 for Coca-Cola, which is found by taking 2,000 minus 500, and 1,000 for AT&T. Next, we find the total fair value. And we do this by taking the number of shares that we own for each different type of stock and multiplying by the fair value. So that will be 1,000 times 90 for Apple, plus 1,500 times 40 for Coca-Cola, plus 1,000 times 28 for AT&T. And if we do that, we get $178,000. Next, we need to find the total cost related to our investments, which is the same process we just used to find the total fair value, except for this time we will be taking the number of shares of each type of stock and multiplying by the cost per share. So that's going to be 1,000 times 85 for Apple, plus 1,500 times 45 for Coca-Cola, plus 1,000 times 25 for AT&T. And when we do that, we get $177,500 for the total cost. Next, we take the total fair value and subtract the total cost. So that's $178,000 minus $177,500, which equals $500. So $500 is our desired debit balance in a new account we're going to use called fair value adjustment. Fair value adjustment is an account that's listed on the balance sheet next to our investments and has a debit balance whenever the fair value is greater than the cost, and a credit balance whenever the fair value is less than the cost of our investments. Now, you may have remembered at the beginning of the video that we stated that the cost of our original investments was equal to the market price or the fair value of those investments. That's equivalent to saying that the fair value adjustment account has a zero balance, which is important for this journal entry that we're about to do here. So if the fair value adjustment account has a desired $500 debit balance, and it currently has a $0 balance, the way we get there is by debiting the fair value adjustment account. And we also put AFS here because we are using available for sale securities. Now the account that goes with this is going to be the unrealized gain equity that we had talked about earlier. Now the reason we know it's an unrealized gain is because the value of the investments increased during the period. The fair value is $500 more than it was last period. If the fair value was less than it was in the previous period, we would have an unrealized loss. Now it's important that you put equity after unrealized gain here to recognize that this account is not going to go on the income statement, but is actually going to go on the equity section of the balance sheet. And the reason for that is because these are AFS, or available for sale securities. If we had trading securities, then we would put unrealized gain income here to recognize that that amount would go on the income statement. Next, on September 1st, 2022, there was a purchase of 700 shares of Moderna stock for $100 per share plus $350 in brokerage fees. Now, the important thing to note here is that the brokerage fees are included in the cost of the investment. So the way we're going to find the total here is take the 700 shares multiplied by $100 per share plus $350. And if we do that, we're going to have a debit to long-term investments, AFS, for $70,350. And the assumption here is that these shares are also going to be AFS, just like the other ones that we had previously. And of course, we're going to have to credit cash because we are paying for these shares, and that's also going to be for $70,350. Next, on November 1st, 2022, 800 shares of Apple stock were sold at $91 per share, less brokerage fees of $200. Now, this entry is going to be very similar to the one that we did with Coca-Cola shares earlier in the video. So I encourage you to take a second and pause the video and see if you can come up with the correct entry for 11-1-2022. All right, we are back. The answers and the correct calculations are showing on the screen now. To find the cash, we took the number of shares that were sold, multiplied by the price per share, and then subtracted the brokerage fees. Then I would go down and figure out the long-term investment amount by taking the cost per share, which was $85 for Apple, multiplying that by 800 shares, which gave us $68,000. Then we could tell that the difference between those two numbers had to be made up on the credit side, so that's going to be a gain on sale of long-term investments. Next, on the last day of 2022, we need to make the fair value adjustment journal entry for 2022. And here we are given the fair value of all the different stocks that we own and also the cost per share. But there's one thing that we have to do for Moderna is we actually have to calculate the cost per share. And the way we do that is we look back up to when we purchased the shares of Moderna stock. It does say $100 per share, but that doesn't include the brokerage fees. So if we take the $70,350 that we paid for these investments and we divide by 700 shares, we get a cost per share for Moderna of $100.50. So I'm going to put that right here. Now to find the fair value adjustment, we have to go through the same process that we did last time. So I want you to try this one on your own as well. Just a reminder of the steps that we need to take. First, we need to figure out how many shares of each type of stock that we own. Then we need to find the total fair value, and then the total cost, and then we need to subtract those two numbers to find the desired balance in the fair value adjustment account. So all I want you to do right now is to find the desired balance in the fair value adjustment account, and then we can do the journal entry together. Okay, the work for how to find the balance of the fair value adjustment account is showing on the screen now. If you weren't able to find a 4,950 credit balance for the fair value adjustment, make sure to pause the video and study the calculations before moving on. So what's different about this fair value adjustment journal entry is now we actually have a balance for the fair value adjustment account. We already had an entry up here on the previous year of a fair value adjustment for $500 debit. So if we want to get to 4,950 credit, we're going to have to credit the account for, well, 500 plus $4,950, which equals $5,450. So that's what I'm going to do down here. I'm going to credit the fair value adjustment account, AFS for $5,450. Now you'll notice that I've left two spaces here for debits that we're going to have to fill out. Now a lot of people will make the mistake of only putting one debit here, and that would be for the unrealized loss and equity. Since we have available for sale securities, the unrealized loss will go on the equity section of the balance sheet. But the thing you're forgetting here, if that's what your journal entry looks like, is that we had an unrealized gain on equity last time around, last year, and that was for $500. So first you have to close out this account. Since this is a permanent account and didn't get closed out when we did closing entries, we'll have to first close out the gain. So we're going to have an unrealized gain on equity. So that had a $500 balance, so we'll first debit that for $500. And then we still have, well, the difference between these two numbers is $4,950, and that ends up being our unrealized loss. Now that's really all the journal entries I wanted to go through with you, but I did want to show you how you would do this last journal entry if you had trading securities instead of available for sale securities. So let's quickly go through that. So you would still have the fair value adjustment account, but it would be called trading or trading securities after it for $5,450. But you're not going to have to split up the other two accounts here. You're not going to have both a gain and a loss, because when you do trading securities, it doesn't go on the equity section of the balance sheet. It goes on the income statement. So any gain or loss would have been closed out. So you don't have to worry about having this split journal entry here. So it actually becomes a little bit easier. It's just going to all go to the unrealized loss for the income statement. And like I said earlier in the video, if you want more practice with trading security type problems, there's going to be a practice problem with the associated PDF that you can try out. All right, we are finally finished with the journal entries. And I know this topic can be a little bit overwhelming at first because there are so many different details and things to keep track of. So if you got a little bit confused along this video, try watching it again maybe in a day or two, and try to pause the video along the way to make sure you understand each step. And before long, you'll be a pro.